Have you ever worked with people who are not as good as they think? Unfortunately, being unaware of your limitations increases your probability of being a boss. But a bigger problem is the fact that most of these leaders are incompetent. Indeed, whether in business or politics, most leaders have very negative effects on their followers and subordinates, causing low levels of engagement, trust and productivity, and high levels of burnout and stress. Anywhere in the world, we assume that confident people have more potential for leadership, but in any area of talent, including leadership, there is just very little overlap between confidence, how good people think they are at something, and competence, how good they actually are at something. If we want to improve the performance of our leaders, we should start by focusing on the right traits. Instead of falling for people who are confident, narcissistic, and charismatic, we should promote people into leadership because of their competence, humility, and integrity.
I wanted to talk about the importance of voting because I do feel that it is really important for us to participate. And that's for a number of reasons. I think first, you know, it's a real opportunity to have your voice heard. And it's an opportunity to determine who our leadership is. It's an opportunity to set and determine the priorities of our community. And certainly has the impact of directing the organization and the band in a certain way, right? So whoever you're voting for really does set the tone at the table, and hopefully when you're voting, you're selecting members that are aligned with your values, because then that reflects the decisions at the table then reflect what the community wants and what the community needs. Now, the law is pretty clear in terms of how to manage conflict of interest. Council members are expected to disclose real or perceived conflicts of interest. They are expected to remove themselves from processes. And finally, they need to not vote in any matters that put them in a position of conflict of interest. So those are the requirements. And OKIB does have a conflict of interest policy. It's important, though, that members at the council table are enforcing those policies and following those policies at all times. You're managing perceptions. At council table, you are always managing perceptions. You are always, you are in a fishbowl, and council is being monitored and watched by its membership. And so if community perceives that conflict of interest, it can damage you, it can damage your reputation, right? So even if council comes in and says, oh, we don't see it as a conflict of interest, careful. You might want to remove yourself anyways, just to manage the perceptions of your constituents.
And that's a really difficult question to answer because I'm not sure how OKIB actually engages its full membership. It's not clear to me that every member receives a send clip. I note that only about 584 to 585 members are voting in the election. I note that on the unofficial page, there's about under 700 members on that page. And I note that on the official page, about 231 members are invited to events. And that suggests to me that there is a huge part of our population that is not engaged. And really, they're missing. They're missing from our community. There's a whole bunch of us that are not being engaged. We're not being talked to. The question was asked, how would I support off reserve? Well, first of all, I really want to know who our off reserve members are. I would like to see full engagement. I'd like to see a plan for that, something that we haven't done, but we need to do. We are missing an entire part of our voice, an entire part of ourselves, by neglecting that part of our population. We really need to get a sense of what their needs and wants are. And I would suggest that before I talk about, you know, how I would support off reserve, I would really like to understand what they need. I would really like to understand, you know, how they would like to be engaged, those kinds of things. Those things need to be answered before, obviously, we can start to offer anything. We need to have the engagement first. So, if elected, that's actually one of my priorities.
There was a time in our nation when we would have nation members, our members, not just our members, but nation members used to travel great distances and they would gather, ironically enough, right where we vote. In Kamapalux, where the people gather, was a place where people used to come and they would sit with leadership, and leadership would listen to their nation members and their community members, and they would collect all of those voices in order to make decisions. Sometimes that process would take months, I've been told, right? Of course, I never witnessed it or experienced it, but I was told and have been told that they would sometimes sit. They would sit as long as it took to collect all of those voices. Now, granted, that's not what we have now. We have a colonial practice that literally tears apart our community every 2 years. It creates significant conflict. It divides families. And for what? For 11 seats at a table. 11 seats at a table, that's what that does. It's a colonial practice. And it's unfortunately the only practice we have at this time until we as a membership get together and collectively determine what our election process should look like. So until then, this is the only process we have to have our voices heard. So I hope this resonated with you. And I hope that you feel inspired to vote and to participate. And I also hope that maybe people will do a little bit of reflecting on how colonization is impacting your day-to-day life and your interactions with community members and youth on or off reserve, just to reflect a little bit about that and reflect a little bit on how this colonial practice is really designed to divide and conquer us. And maybe it'll motivate our membership to want to reclaim this process and make it our own. And with that, white lim lim.